Great, well...
And you can hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay, so you can hear me for slide advance.
Great. So thank you, everyone, for joining us today. This is the second seminar in the Lunar Commerce Seminar Series. And we have people from all over the world joining today, so thanks so much for joining. Today we have a speaker who has a wonderful long history with the space program and the moon. Dr. Douglas Curry is a professor at the University of Maryland, where he's speaking from today. And he was on the science team of the original Apollo-era lunar laser ranging team, and was the scientific director for the Lunar Laser Ranging Station at McDonald Observatory. He has an extensive history with instruments, astronomy-related instruments, throughout his career for a number of purposes. And he is also a member of one of the NLSI teams, the lunar team led by Dr. Jack Burns. And he has a long history of other projects, including working on the Hubble Space Telescope and working on various government applications. And today he'll be speaking on the future, looking forward for lunar laser ranging. And he has an interest in commercial space as a possible way to get his science forwarded. And he will have supplemental material posted online at our website, lunarscience.nasa.gov/events/Curry. We'll be posting that later as well. So with that, very lucky to have Doug Curry. Thanks.
Okay, thank you, Delia. What I'd like to do is talk a little bit about our project for the next generation of lunar ranging on the moon. I'll hit a number of points rather quickly, and the backup is going to be on this website that Delia mentioned, so that if, rather than try and have you copy websites for different groups of on the fly, they'll all be presented there. So this is a part of the NSLI lunar team that's centered at University of Colorado. Lunar ranging is one of the three projects. The other two are radio astronomy and radio astronomy to do cosmology and radio astronomy to do heliophysics. All right, for laser ranging, first, talk a little bit about the science heritage in the Apollo arrays, current status of the science objectives of lunar laser ranging, and then the objectives for the next generation, challenges, and something about the robotic emplacement. Then address, will it work? First, the heritage, then computer simulations on the optical and thermal performance, and thermal vac testing, and some of the critical vendors and flight opportunities. Next slide. Why should we do laser ranging? Mainly because it's exquisitely precise. And this range isn't just something you measure once, like clam shift or something. You're measuring many measurements, and that's giving you a handle on not only general relativity, but also on geophysics, or Earth satellites, or selenophysics, the interior of the moon. Satellite ranging is a long history. LAGEOS and other satellites that tells us about the gravity field of the Earth and crustal properties, etc., of the Earth. Next slide. What do I mean by precise? Currently, the Apollo station, run by Tom Murphy, is ranging at 2.4 parts per trillion. If my eyes were this good, I could read a license plate on the moon, or I could inspect someone's DNA and amino acids in San Francisco from Washington. So the kind of precision we're talking about is really one of the highest in physics. It allows us to detect teeny general relativity effects and to detect the sloshing around of the liquid core. Next slide. Next slide after that. Why should we do laser ranging to the moon? Ideally, we want to track an object which travels on a geodesic in general relativity. Why are the problems? Why don't we use a satellite? Well, some of the photons from the sun bump into a satellite and push it into a new orbit. That's the kind of level we're talking. In addition, satellite gets warmed by the sun. When it rotates, the infrared photons that are pushed out push it to a new orbit. The moon has much greater mass, mass to surface ratio. Besides, we learn about the inside of the moon. Next slide. The retroreflector on the moon went up with Apollo 11, 1969. But what do I mean by laser ranging? What we do is we send up a very short laser pulse. Time, how long it takes between transmission and reflection. But simple reflection from the lunar surface is much too weak. So we need some gadget, what we've called the corner reflector, the retroreflector. If I have the laser beam going up, it hits this, bounces back, and lo and behold, it comes back in exactly the same direction that it was sent out. That means it comes to first order. It comes back to the transmitting station. That gives us a strong, or stronger, not necessarily very strong, return level. What have the Apollo arrays done? Well, let me not run through all this. Simply say some of the best tests in general relativity have come out of lunar laser ranging and knowledge of the interior of the moon. For example, it does have a liquid core. We have some idea of what the shape of that liquid core is. However, further measurements on the liquid core, how it's rotating, whether there's a solid inner core, await more precise measurements. Right. This is a nice game to play, but how does this sit in the general science community? Every 10 years, NASA runs what's called a decadal survey, and they take input from the whole community, the astronomical, geophysical community, and committees then sift through this to define what are the best things for NASA to be involved in for the next generation, or next 10 years, next decade. The report by the Gravity and Particle Physics panel was very highly positive on lunar ranging. And I'm not going to go through them, but their report highlights lunar laser ranging considerably. What science do we want out of this? We have the elastic tides of the moon. The moon bends not very much, not like the Earth. The Earth rotates with respect to the moon, and so therefore there are fairly high tides, because you go around 360 degrees. The moon only goes plus or minus about 8 degrees, so the tides are considerably smaller. But both the magnitude and the loss of energy, dispersion of the tidal effects, tells us about the interior of the moon. And that dissipation tells us something about the interface between the liquid core and the surrounding solid mantle. And then a number of other advantages, and it also gives us very precise coordinate system to locate things later on the moon, landings and so on. For general relativity, strong and weak equivalence principles. What we found to date is that the time variation of the gravitational constant is sufficiently small that in the history of the universe, it's only changed, it could only have changed by a few percent at most. That and deviations from 1 over r squared allow us to look at different gravitational theories. Why is this important? Well, fundamentally, general relativity and quantum mechanics are inconsistent. So if we want to have a consistent understanding, we have to find out which of these breaks down. And general relativity in general is less well tested at the very fine details in quantum mechanics. So that's the reason for pushing hard on what are the possible errors in general relativity, although to date we haven't found problems. That's repeat of the same. So, I'm sorry. Let's hit a few more slides. Sorry, Ricky. Next one. This was the overview of the lunar science, the overview of the relativity science that I just talked about. And then the next one, Ricky. And next one. Okay, a short history. The Apollo arrays went up in 1969. And the plot shows the accuracy for each year since I was out there in 1969. During the early years, we had not so many people observing, and we had observations being conducted on large telescopes, which meant they didn't have a lot of time, and so there weren't as many observations. In the 80s, what happened was that some smaller telescopes got running. They took lots of measurements, and so we pushed down the errors to the couple centimeter level, and that's where it's been sitting up to very recently. The more recent history is that in 06, people started talking about going back to the moon. And so we might look at ways that we could reduce that 2 centimeters considerably. In 07, NASA awarded us a LSSO contract to work on this 100-millimeter reflector. And in 2009, NSLI, through its lunar program at the University of Colorado, continued this effort. Why do we have to make any changes? The problem is that the array that's up there now consists of 100 corner reflectors on a panel. That's fine, but when the moon rotates a little bit like this, this corner is further away than this corner by about 15 centimeters. That means that no matter what we do, we have an uncertainty in there of centimeters that cannot be gotten rid of except perhaps by taking many, many thousands of observations, which Tom Murphy at the Apollo station is doing and getting down to under 2 millimeters. But that's a large telescope, and he can't get continuous observations. Next slide. These are some results that Tom took, indicating that this problem is real, not theoretical. And in the third one over, what you see there is basically the full 15 centimeters that you get the spread. This is when the array was tipped, essentially the full amount. Next slide. So, the new program, the Lunar Laser Ranging Retroreflector Array for the 21st Century. It's a solid 100-millimeter corner reflector. Looks something like this. like this. This is not light unit. This is one that I purchased back in the Apollo days in order to do telescope pointing, but it is the same size, and we've used it for some of the testing. The use of these kind of corner reflectors now has a 42-year heritage on the moon. In addition, actually, this is one of the engineering models of the corner reflectors that was made during the Apollo days. This design, mechanical design, has also been used for satellites. This is what I was working on back in the Apollo days, was the design and thermal testing of this. And this design is used on Lagos, and there are hundreds of these in satellite orbits that are continuing to work properly, continued to work for decades. The technology readiness level, TRL, for package itself was evaluated by someone on the outside at 6.5, which means essentially very close to being ready to fly. Next question is, we want a robotic deployment. The robotic deployment could be done in a couple different ways. One is to be fastened to the lander. That's a little difficult because from day to night, the lander expands, contracts as the temperatures go through 300 degrees. So that I will certainly take that as a ride, but that's not the preferable. The phase one view is on the surface, and that will support submillimeter ranging, and hope is that that could be done in 2013 or 14. Second phase says, now we got a problem on the surface. During the day, the surface expands, and that expansion is a good part of half a millimeter. We're talking about wanting to have much better range. So if we go down about a meter, the temperature does not penetrate that far. And so therefore, if I could anchor it 1 meter down, then I could get a much more stable reference to the local regolith, local crust, lunar crust. In that case, it would support single photoelectron ranging of 100 microns or less, and that we could look at as 2016, 2017. Next slide. In order to put this together, I first assembled the LSSO team that was mostly U.S. For the new work. We're working very closely with the Italians at INFN, and they are making a very large contribution, especially for the testing. I won't go through this in detail. This will be listed on the reference webpage. Next slide. So what are the problems with doing this? In other words, we flew this. It's been working 40 years. Why not just go ahead with this? Well, there are three issues. The first is making this. Not this one, but the real one. The tolerances on these angles are beyond what are currently used in corner reflectors. The homogeneity of the material has to be a little bit better than it was back in the Apollo days, mainly because the light has to go through more material. And finally, you have to be able to get pieces of material this big. Second challenge is, are we going to get a reasonable return? This is actually only one reflector, and we're normally looking at 100 or 300. Next is the sun falls on this. Some of the heat light gets absorbed, heats up, blows out space. The temperature, then you have a gradient. The index of refraction depends upon the temperature. And so therefore, if there's a strong temperature gradient here, then the beam coming out will get spread. And so instead of coming right back, it'll come like this. And our little telescope won't collect enough light. And there are various things that have to look at. That absorption, the conduction, because I have to hold it somehow, and radiation. One of the big ones is the mounting structure. Might be hot, it's cold, and so therefore you'll get heat flow. Finally, there's the stability with respect to the lunar surface. And as I mentioned, the regolith heating and drilling down to a lower layer. Next, do that. As far as the fabrication, we've done it. We made a 100 millimeter corona reflector, met the specs. The spec actually exceeded the specs significantly. It is flight qualified, and it is currently being used in the thermal vac testing over in Italy. For the thermal analysis, what we're doing is we're looking at the solar spectrum, the absorption in the material we want to use, SuperSil 311. We compute how far each 1 nanometer band of wavelength penetrates in here, what it deposits at each point, CCR. We then put that into a we put that into a commercial thermal analysis program. That gives us the temperature at every point in here. We then feed that into a Maryland program that converts the temperatures into errors in the wavefront. Feed that to code 5. And that gives us the optical distortions due to the errors in the angle and the material and the phases on reflection, the total internal reflection. Next slide. This is a discussion of, with the picture of the package, the flow of heat that comes in through the little tabs that support this, since it can't float in space, it's still got lunar gravity holding it. In order to stop the radiation that comes from the surrounding pocket, what we have are two cans that have a gold surface finish that has an extremely low emissivity. And those are shown here as the two gold cans, and again, those have been these are fabrication. The one on the left is the outer shield, and that's as it's being wired up with thermocouples for the test in Frascati. The one on the right is the newly made formal inner shield, which we hope to be testing over the summer. Next slide. Next slide. These are the two shields that I mentioned. And then the next slide. The Apollo array essentially had the corona reflector sitting out here with the sun hitting it. For the larger corona reflector, that turns out to be unacceptable. And so the procedure is to make a sunshade so that, in general, the sun doesn't get in here. It does get in at lunar noontime, but most of the time it doesn't get in. So that becomes an essential part. In addition, this blocks dust falling on here. The Apollo corner reflectors have actually had their reflectivity reduced by a factor of 10 over the past 42 years. And I'll come back to this, but we believe that's due to dust or to pitting by high-speed micrometeorites. And we want to find out what's going on there, but this will do a large amount of the shielding. What do we have to do with this? Well, on the outside, we want it to be very reflective in the visible, so we don't deposit much heat, and highly emissive in the infrared, so that what heat is there tends to go out. Inside, we want it black for the visible, so we don't dump more light energy down into the corner reflector. But then, very low emissivity, so that when this gets hot, it doesn't put infrared. We'll see that in some of the simulations. Next slide. This is the package that we're testing over in Frascati. This has 100 millimeter sunshade as opposed to the nominal design of 200. The corner reflectors in there, the two gold cans are in there, and the mounting pins are there. Next slide. So what do we mean by thermal simulation? Well, after we get the deposit, in order to get the deposit, what we do is we do this for a full lunation. It's set up both for the deposition of the heat and the behavior on the rest of the package. Ricky, can we make it run around? The sun is in the center and the package goes around the sun, so we're getting the full behavior of lunation. The sun is over on the left. The Earth is at the center of this black circle, and the moon is going around that. Next slide. This is really just a review of what I said before on the analysis. I won't repeat this. This tells a little more detail about the software and packages that are used in order to do the analysis. Next slide. This is an example. This is actually looking at the 100 millimeter sunshade. The reason for this is twofold. One is some of the people who want to fly it don't like such a big package. Of course, it's two and a half times bigger than this. And so the question was, can we go with a smaller sunshade? And number two, the current thermovac test is the smaller. So what we have here is two different examples of properties. In this case, this particular one, it's one of many, is whether we have multi-layer insulation and then a second surface mirror, or whether we have no multi-layer insulation. And we see the quite radical differences. The black line is the temperature gradient from tip to front face, which is really the most important number. The dip at the beginning in the black, the negative dip, is because the sun hits this, heats up, that heats the front face of the corner reflector, that in turn then flows back through the corner reflector. So that's negative. The one later is the sun breaking through this total internal reflection. If we put silver on here, it would heat up so much that it was not acceptable. So we use total internal reflection, and then that works, but then the sun can go through and heat up that inner gold can, and that's what happens here. This is the reason we take the 200 millimeter as nominal, because that doesn't happen with the 200 millimeter. Next slide. This is one of our simulations of a while ago of the corner reflector for the anchored. In other words, when we have it down underneath, and there's a blanket that surrounds the corner reflector in the center. And what that does is it keeps the temperature more uniform underneath this blanket. And so during the lunar night, you get a relatively small change in temperature, and then the post it's sitting on would be made out of silicon carbide, which has a very low temperature coefficient, more like Invar. We can also then look at the changes in the corner reflector. Next animation, Ricky. And here, during a lunar month, what we're seeing are the temperature differences in the corner reflector. And that, in turn, we can use to determine how much spreading we're going to get and keep that acceptable. Next view graph. So up to now, next one, Ricky. Up to now, I've been talking theory. So the question is, how does this behave? This, on the lunar surface, we go from 350 degrees at noon to about 50 degrees Kelvin at night. That's 300 degrees. Do things survive? What happens to them? In order to do this, we need to do actual thermal testing of this corner reflector that we fabricated. This is being done over at INFN. It's in Italy. That INFN is sort of the equivalent of our civilian side of the Department of Energy. They do a lot of particle physics. But they've branched out and are looking into space operations, and they've done a very generous development of a chamber to test retroreflectors, both for lunar and for satellites. And this is an illustration of this. This takes place at INFN, the Laboratory of Nuclear Physics in Frascati, a suburb of Rome. And so we're going to, on the left of the picture is where a big solar simulator sends in a solar constant. Then on the, there's a window that looks through a silicon window, so that we can look at the temperature variations with an IR camera. And then further down, there is a port, which we, with a very good optical window, and that we can look at diffraction patterns that come back from the corner. And so there have been about three tests of this to date, and we're hoping for one this summer. This is an example. This is the IR camera looking at it. On the left, the image shows normal dynamic range. But on the right, we've scaled it up and looked at it in more detail so that we're seeing a degree rather than 100 degrees. And that pattern you see is due to the conduction of the tabs, mount conductance. And you actually, if you'd look carefully, would have seen that pattern on the corner reflector that we had the test earlier. Next slide. As I mentioned, the Apollo arrays are down by a factor of 10. There are various theories of why this occurs. On the other hand, having five theories, rather hard to build equipment that that takes care of all five, and so therefore we really want to find out what the story is. One of the possibilities is just dust being deposited. For that, we're hoping a couple things. We're hoping that this sunshade is going to protect it, and there's another procedure we might use. But one of the other theories is that we have micrometeorites that come in and dig a little crater. Information on whether that might occur or not is extremely sparse. On the other hand, Mikhail Aruni at the University of Colorado, who leads another team like our lunar team with Jack Burns, Kyle leads a team that is looking more at dust in the lunar atmosphere. In order to study these things, he's building a dust accelerator that will accelerate little particles of dust to the kind of velocity that you would expect them to be coming in at surface. And so at present, we're planning on the 1st of May, 1st of April, he's going to get it running. 1st of May will be the first external user, and we'll be taking our witness samples out there, bombarding them with this dust, and then looking at them both optical microscope and SEM. Next slide. This addresses what the signal strength we expect to get. I'm not going to go through the detailed calculations right now, but basically, at present on the moon, there's the Apollo 11 array, there's the Apollo 14 array, and there's the Apollo 15. The Apollo 15 is three times larger, has 300 retroreflectors. So it has a nice signal, and that's the one that people most often want to look at from the ground stations. And what we end up with is that we get almost the same strength from this single retroreflector as the 300 gives at present. So at least during the first decade, we should have a package which does not have the libration problem, very stable, and gives a return that is very useful. In addition, there are two other arrays up there. The Russians put some lunahods, which look sort of like tractors. And on each of those, there is a retroreflector array. One of them has been used. It has decayed even more than the Apollo. The other lunahod one could not be found. So for 40 years, nothing hasn't been used. LRO, which is the recent orbiter around the moon, and taking very high resolution pictures of the surface, found lunahod. Tom Murphy has been ranging to it. And for some reason, it violates the rule up there. It's very bright. It did not decay. So we have now five arrays up there that we can range to, but all of them are suffering from both the libration problem, and in the case of the lunahods, it's up here on a big vehicle, and so it's day to night bouncing up and down. Okay, deployment. Certainly in the next, won't say how long, certainly the next while, we're going to have to do robotic, not manned, although the plan that I started out with. One is a lander. That'll be a few millimeters through the expansion of the lander during surface deployment, submillimeter. Regolith expansion will make that not perfect. And finally, anchored, going down a meter, and that ends up being in principle available at tens of microns. Flight opportunities. There's the Google X Prize, And two of the groups, Astrobotics and Moon Express, have expressed an interest in flying their retroreflector, get funding for it. In addition, with a backup for a Lunette proposal, which is the Discovery mission. And then finally, NASA has looked at, it's now on the back burner, but the International Lunar Network is a future possibility. All of those are robotic. For robotic emplacement, there are three angles that are very important. One is that it's supposed to look toward the Earth, in fact, for two reasons. One is got the sunshade on it, and second, we get a reduction of signal if it's pointing in the wrong direction. In addition, there's a problem of velocity aberration. The Earth is rotating. So our very clever corner reflector sends light back where it came from. But in that 2.5 seconds, the ground station is rotated and it's no longer exactly where the beam is coming back. In addition, the moon is moving. The moon is moving. And so, but they actually cancel a little bit, so we're helped. So what we want to do is we want to spread the beam out a little bit in the direction of this velocity. And so we end up saying that we want to know what this is to about 1 degree. So the question is, how do we do that robotically? Robotics, we may be on a slope. On Apollo, we said, all right, go to a level place and point it, and the array was tipped according to the latitude of the site, and then the astronauts tipped it back and forth with a little sunshade to tell them when the right value was. Robotic landing, we may be up to 10 degrees tilt, which is an acceptable thing for most of the flights, and that would not do it. So we'd have to play a different game. What we can do is, for two of the three angles, we can use gravity. If this is my package, then, and I had a string, then this angle is determined by gravity. Even though the ground may be tilted, that doesn't matter, it's still going to be the right angle. Likewise, this angle is determined by gravity. So two out of the three are determined. The arm which deploys it is going to have to nudge it around at a third angle. Of course, the other problem is that we have difficulty finding space-qualified strings that don't twist. But if you get fancy, you can make such a thing. Next slide. Okay, this this talks about the anchored deployment. If we go down to 1 meter, then we can get something that the ground is moving much less than 10 microns. We want to stabilize that temperature, as I showed in the simulation, with a blanket. And that, in principle, looks reasonable and looks like it would be very stable. Problem is, how do you drill? This we covered. For the surface deployment, this is what we're looking at, is a tripod to hold this device. Talking to SSG up in near Boston to build this out of silicon carbide. Part of this deployment is up in the air because we haven't got an explicit flight details yet. This we've talked about. Okay, this again is saying we can go down at 1 meter where it's a tiny fraction of a degree variation and then anchor at the base. But again, the question is, how do we drill? What's the history of drilling on the moon? I'm sorry, Ricky, advance. And again, that's the surface deployment device that is SSG is looking at present. Next slide. And next slide. And next slide. Okay, Jack Schmidt, in talking to him, he gave me this video of what drilling was like in Apollo 17.
You're saying they can back
they trying to
use
their
hands up and all that.
Then do it clockwise.
It's better than the treadmill.
Right, they say give it a slight rotation clockwise as it's lifting out.
Okay.
So the main conclusion is we're going to have to figure out how to do
you copy what else I'm saying here? Yes, I did. Is that what you guys have done down to
Chris Zachney at a company called Honeybee has been working on robotic procedures for drilling. And in the next viewgraph, next animation. This is in Chris's lab. That's Chris walking away. The corner reflector is that black thing up there. It's sitting on a rod. What Chris is doing is turning on air, blowing out through the tip, therefore blowing the regolith, the dust, the soil, out in the hole. And so just the weight of the corner reflector is sufficient to allow it to We repeated that test, Canadian Space Agency, NASA, and the German Space Agency conducted tests on Mauna Kea, which is representative in the regolith, and we performed the same test where, again, the weight was enough to drive it. And Chris is going to be working over the next period on a design or a rover in order to do the placement. Next viewgraph. Critical vendors, I think I'm running out of time. The cube corner reflector is made by ITE in Oral, Maryland with Ed Aaron. Those references will be on the website. Next slide. The thermal shields are being done by Eppner Technologies, David Eppner. And again, this will be on the website. He's made the ones that we are using in the thermal tests. Next slide. And the silicon carbide is being done by L3, SSG, and Joe Robichard is the person who's handling that. They've made fabrications for JPL, NASA, and NRL. Next slide. The one thing we've left out on this is I've been talking about what we do on the moon. Current ground stations are not set up to take advantage of this, and so therefore there will be a need to upgrade ground stations and or develop new ground stations in order to be able to take advantage of this. But this is a whole separate topic. And so, next slide. Mission opportunities, both in NASA, it is planned to be carried on a Italian mission, and the Italians have started a lunar program. Next slide. And support of this at the University of Maryland has been NASA's LSSO, NASA through NSLI, to University of Colorado, to Maryland. The primary support for the Frascati effort has been INFN and the Italian Space Agency, plus many individuals. Finally, next slide. Okay, thank you.
Hey, let's all thank Doug for the talk. Great, and for the folks on Adobe Connect, you can raise your hand with the little button below and ask questions, and we'll read them out. And the first one I'm seeing right now is from Mike Joyce, the question of total estimated instrument landed mass.
Or the base package is the current one we're testing is 1.4 kilograms. We have not yet lightweighted it, so it's less than 1.4 kilograms. The weight of the frame is currently in progress. Its wild guess is about 1 kilogram. And so we're saying less than 2.5 to 3 kilograms.
Great, thanks. From Nick Evitz, what kind of data transfer systems?
This one of our advantages in Apollo 11, they had a wonderful science package. The astronauts started practicing with it, said, some people say we're going to sink 30 feet into the dust and you want us to do all of this stuff? So NASA asked for experiments. And I'm being a little facetious here, experiments that required no power, no communication, etc. And our retroreflectors arrays satisfy that. They're just really some quartz rocks in a piece of aluminum. The data comes from the time interval between this and this. So this delta T is the science. And we measure that delta T many times during the lunar orbit and during lunar rotations. And so the data issue is really a ground station issue. We don't have any space need for that. This is then fed to Jim Williams out at JPL. Others do the analysis also, but Jim is probably the most accurate to date, and he puts this into a very complex program, includes oceans of Jupiter and so on, in order to then optimize the parameters that tell us in detail how much rotation there is. Basically, the rotation tells us about the moon physics, and where it is in its orbit, basically telling us about general relativity. Any further questions?
From Alex Dobransky, about drilling. What's the impact from the last stage? Can it nail anything deep enough?
Little puzzled by that question. Impact of the last stage. The lander, this would be mounted on a rover, and it will move away from the lander. So I don't think we will be affected by any impact of the lander, if that's what he means. Sorry.
Okay, and Alex, if you want to rephrase that question, we can revisit it at the end. From Mike Joyce, would there be any advantage to an array of two or more reflectors greater than a half kilometer apart?
That was the original proposal I had in LSSO, and that's why you've been listening to something in which I talked about one retroreflector, and the title is Retroreflector Array. especially for the drilled, where we're looking for a very high accuracy for the anchors. What if it runs into the rock? How do I know? If I have something like five arrays separated by 10 meters is certainly enough, then I can compare them, know that they're all behaving properly, or if one of them behaves badly, I can remove it from my averaging. And so, yes, that would be very interesting, and depending upon how complicated things are, Chris is going to be looking at whether we could deploy five of them from the lander rather than just one, from the rover rather than just one. Okay, Delia, I think I have to leave. We've got another group in the room here.
Okay, and there's...
Okay. By the way, any further questions, happy to have them put on that website and or send me an email. Okay, and thank you.
Great, let's thank Doug one more time. And again, we'll be posting that information online at the URL you can see in the notes section. And we'll see you next month for another Lunar Commerce seminar. Thanks, everyone.